Okay, here we go again. Thanks everyone for joining us wherever you are in the world. I hope you're going to enjoy this session. Our first speaker is Henriette Pilgaard. Can't think of anyone better to open the talk and to this session to talk about the role of mitochondria in health. Henriette always gives a great talk, and she'll probably remember, but I actually learned how to measure PGC1 alpha mRNA in her laboratory probably close to 20 years ago. And so she's helped to foster my interest in this area. And thanks for agreeing to speak, and I'm looking forward to the talk. Thanks, Henriette.
Thank you very much, David. Thank you for the invitation to take part in this session and for the kind introduction. Sure, I remember, although it's many years ago. So I have been given this title, The Role of Mitochondria in Health, and I will focus on the mitochondria in health, but will focus on aging and exercise training especially. So we all know that endurance exercise training induces multiple adaptations, including metabolic adaptations, and that's adaptations that will affect both performance and having health benefits. And one of the major adaptations that are occurring metabolic wise, that's affecting the mitochondria. And the mitochondria, they are double membrane organelles that are having several key metabolic pathways inside, either in the matrix or in the inner membrane. And these metabolic pathways include the beta oxidation, the TCA cycle, and the PDC reaction, and for sure, the electron transport system. A key point is that these reactions, the PDC, beta oxidation, and TCA cycle, they produce NADH and FADH2, and they deliver electrons to the electron transport system. The electron transport system consists of several proteins, but the major parts are these five complexes. And NADH and FADH2, they are reducing equivalents. So as said, delivering electrons to complex 1 and 2. And this is followed by the transport of electrons through the first 4 complexes. This is accompanied by the pumping of protons across the inner membrane from the matrix to the inner membrane space, creating a proton gradient, a proton motive force, which is used by the ATP synthase to produce ATP. So this really emphasizes the key role of mitochondria in metabolic path, in metabolic regulation, and in metabolism as such. In addition, during this transport of electrons in the transport system, some electrons may escape and react with oxygen, producing superoxide. They are important molecules, they are important in signaling in the cell. But if the demand of substrate is higher than the requirement of ATP production, then this production may increase and potentially cause oxidative damage. This also emphasizes the importance of keeping a well balance of the ROS, production and removal. It has been known for many years that exercise training is causing increased content and activity of mitochondrial enzymes. This was first shown by Hollacy in 67, and he showed that rats training for 12 weeks, they increased the content of mitochondrial proteins from the sedentary to the trained rats, and also the COX activity was shown to be almost doubled in the trained rats. So these are some of the first studies showing this. And over the following years, it was shown that this also is the case in human skeletal muscle, here shown from with different activity levels of the subjects. And this has become the routine measurements to test whether an exercise protocol is affecting the mitochondrial capacity, measuring mitochondrial enzyme content and maybe also the specific activity of these enzymes. However, it should be emphasized that it's not only the content of the mitochondrial proteins that are important. It's also the function of the mitochondria. And of course, that is very important. And the function of the mitochondria and the mitochondrial pool, that is determined to a large extent of the dynamics between fusion of mitochondria and fission of mitochondria, and the removal of dysfunctional mitochondria by mitophagy. And this figure is from Xinyan, and in this suggesting that exercise training is not only affecting mitochondrial biogenesis, but also the process of fusion, fission, and mitophagy, and thereby making it possible to not only regulate the amount of mitochondria, but also the quality of the mitochondria. So the autophagy is the removal of components such as proteins, and mitophagy is a special form of autophagy as it's a selective removal of mitochondria. And this occurs if the mitochondria is dysfunctional, the pink is accumulating on the outer membrane, recruiting parkin, which is ubiquitinating surface proteins, so that the mitochondria will interact with P62 bound to LC32. And another pathway of mitophagy is that NIP3 and NIX are activated on the surface of the mitochondria, interacting with LC32. And LC32 is associated with the autophagosome. And LC32 is often used as a marker of the number of autophagosomes. So LC32 is produced from LC31, where LC31 is in the cytosol. And by lipidation, LC32 is formed and binding to the autophagosome. So when these dysfunctional mitochondria are marked, they will be engulfed by the growing autophagosome, which will fuse with lysosomes, and thereby it will be degraded and dysfunctional mitochondria will be removed. So we ask whether exercise training regulate autophagy and mitophagy markers in human skeletal muscle. And this was by training healthy young male subjects 8 weeks, either by a protocol with moderate intensity exercise training with continuous bouts of exercise, or a parallel training with sprint exercise bouts, but with these exercise protocols having the same total energy requirement. So this is before training and this after training in the moderate intensity exercise protocol and the sprint protocol. And as evident, the COX-1 protein, a marker of mitochondrial content, that it is increased with exercise training as expected. But also the LC32 protein, this autophagosome protein that is converted to LC32 by lipidation. So you can see that this is also increasing in parallel with increasing of the complexes. And also the mitophagy proteins, NIP3 and parkin, they are increasing as well, indicating that training adaptations in mitochondrial proteins, metabolic proteins, are in parallel with adaptations in autophagy and mitophagy markers, making it possible for the cell to keep track of the quality of the mitochondria. So it seems that endurance exercise training increases both the content of metabolic oxidative proteins and in parallel key proteins in autophagy and mitophagy in human skeletal muscle. So we have been very interested in what factors may mediate such changes. And there are no doubt that there are many factors involved in this. We all know that. But we have had in special interest in PDC1 alpha. So by going on with this doesn't mean that there are not other factors. But we have been interested in PDC1 alpha after seeing this first picture that Spiegelman showed, or this is one of our own pictures, but he showed a similar picture where overexpression of PDS1 alpha in mouse skeletal muscle turns the otherwise very wide and glycolytic muscle dark red. And this is associated with markedly higher cytochrome C protein in the muscle and also markedly higher CS activity. It has been shown also that these mice have improved endurance. So it seems that these adaptation or these changes are associated with functional effects. And when we knock out PDC1 alpha, then correspondingly cytochrome C protein is lower and CS activity is also lower. Clearly, there are still mitochondria left in these mice and they can run, but they do run less well than a wild type mouse. So we ask whether PDC1 alpha may be contributing to exercise training induced regulation of autophagy and mitophagy capacity in mouse skeletal muscle. So we used PDC1 alpha muscle specific knockout mice and their littermate controls. And they exercise trained for 5 weeks using a running wheel. And this shows the CS activity in the muscle. Now I lost my this one. And you can see the gray one, the gray columns, that's the control mice. And from controls to exercise training, there's an increase in CS activity as expected and as seen in the human skeletal muscle. The knockouts, they have clearly lower level of CS activity, but as noticed here, you can see that there is a training effect. So this is in accordance with what we have seen previously, and also other groups have reported that PDC1 alpha may not be mandatory for exercise training induced increases in metabolic proteins and enzyme activity. But if we look at the LC3-1 protein, this protein involved in autophagy and mitophagy, there's a clear effect with training in the controls, but no effect in the knockouts whatsoever. The P62, which is also involved in autophagy, is also increasing with training in the controls, but not at all in the knockouts. The mitophagy protein, BLIP3, is also increasing as we saw in humans, and is increasing both in the controls and in the knockouts. So here, PDC1 alpha does not seem to be required. But for the other mitophagy protein, parkin, there's a clear effect with training in controls, but no effect in the knockouts. And this is with a protocol of exercise training where we ensure that the control, the LOX-LOX mice, and the knockouts, they run the same distance. So this seems that PDC1 alpha is required for exercise training induced increases in some of the autophagy and mitophagy factors in mouse skeletal muscle. And it suggested that PDC1 alpha therefore also may mediate these changes that we see in humans. And it seems that PDC1 alpha is not just a regulator of mitochondrial biogenesis, but is definitely also regulating parallel important processes. We need to remember that mitochondria, especially in skeletal muscle, are not single lying organelles. They form a very organized network in skeletal muscle fibers, as shown here with from a COX-4 staining. And we ask whether aging and lifelong exercise training affect the mitochondrial network in mouse skeletal muscle, and whether PDC1 alpha is required for effects of lifelong exercise training on the network. And we used here whole body PDC1 alpha knockout mice and wild type mice. So we have a young untrained group, an aged untrained group, and an aged trained group. This shows the CS activity. And we do not see any aging effect in this study, but we have a training effect in the control mice. The knockouts have lower levels and they do not adapt with exercise training at this type of exercise, which is a lifelong exercise training. But although we do not see these aging effects, then there seem to be effects on the mitochondrial structure. This is a single fiber from a young wild-type mouse, a single fiber from a P2N alpha knockout mice, a young. And you can see here with highlighted that it's very clear that there is more fragmentation in the knockouts than the wild type. And if we look at the AIDS mice, then there are fragmentations in the wild types and certainly still also in the knockouts. But the mice that were allowed to exercise train throughout life, they have not this fragmentation. So the lifelong exercise training prevents this fragmentation in the wild types, but they do not prevent in the knockouts. So by making an image segmentation, it's possible to analyze the area that is covered by individual mitochondria and the total mitochondria area. And this ratio, individual mitochondria divided by the total, that is typically used as a fragmentation index to get a measure of how fragmented this network is. And by doing so, we have the mitochondrial fragmentation index on the y-axis, and we have the three overall groups, the dark, the wild type, and the gray, the knockout mice. And it's clear that in the controls, that there is a clear increase in fragmentation with aging, and it's totally prevented by lifelong exercise training. The knockouts have more fragmentation, and they have the same with aging, and they have no benefit of the lifelong exercise training. And in accordance with this fragmentation, then the LC3-2 protein, this protein that is bound to the autophagosome and is used as a measure of number of autophagosomes, it's also increasing with age, and it's prevented by exercise training, while there's no significant changes within the knockouts. And the FIS1 protein, which is a key protein in the fission protein, in the fission process. The fission process is where the dysfunctional mitochondria is removed from the mitochondrial network. And it also shows the same pattern, increases with aging, and is prevented by exercise training in the controls. There's also an increase with aging in the knockouts, but they have higher level of FIS1 throughout, and there's no effect of exercise training. These changes were associated with increased protein carboxylation, an indication of oxidative stress. So it's increased with aging, and it's prevented by exercise training. It's higher in the knockouts, it's also increasing, but to our surprise, then the knockouts, they do benefit from the exercise training in the oxidative stress marker. So this is kind of a dissociation, so seeming that the effects with exercise training with the lack of exercise training effects in the knockouts on the mitochondrial network does not seem to be due to lack of improvement in oxidative stress. So we then also ask whether can exercise training at old age reverse an age-associated change in mitochondrial network. The other one was lifelong. Can we, with just a few weeks of exercise training, rescue this? And is it dependent on PDC1 alpha? So similar as before, we had the single fibers and here labeled or marked both for the COX-4, but also for the myosin heavy chain 2. And this is also the mice are 17 weeks old at the age state, and they exercise train only for 6 weeks at old age. And when we analyze the mitochondrial fragmentation, we see the same. We have an increase in fragmentation with age, and it is totally rescued with just 7 weeks of exercise training. And it's totally dependent on PDC1 alpha because there's no rescue with exercise training in the knockout mice. So this really, I think, shows the dynamics of the mitochondrial network that is just not a firm structure, but it can be changed, it's affected by aging, and it's very much possible to change with exercise training. And this is important because it has been suggested that the mitochondrial network structure, that the continuation and the lack of fragmentation, that is really crucial for the function of the mitochondria, that they work much more efficient if we have the mitochondria with less fragmentation. So this showed that aging was associated with mitochondrial fragmentation in mouse muscle, and both lifelong exercise training could prevent that, but also exercise training just performed at old age. And the studies show that P2N alpha was required both for the beneficial effect of lifelong exercise training and for the effect of exercise training at old age. Because we think that the structure is important for the function, we also ask whether this training at late life, is that possible to affect mitochondrial function? And is P2N alpha required for that? So this is from the last study that I showed, and this shows respiration measured in permeabilized muscle fibers using the Ouroboros system. And this shows the complex 1 link respiration with a high concentration of ADP. This shows that aging is decreasing respiration, but training for these 7 weeks totally reverses this. P2N alpha knockout mice have a lower respiration. It's also lower with age, and they are able to rescue this. But this is a very high concentration of ADP. It's super physiological levels. So therefore, we also measured at a more physiological level, 0.1 millimolar of ADP. Here we see again a decrease with age, and it's rescued with exercise training. The knockout mice have lower level, and they are not able to rescue that with exercise training as the controls are. And I would like to emphasize that these changes with age and exercise training in function, they occur without changes in CS activity as an often used marker of mitochondrial content. So it seems that these changes in function are not due to more or less content of mitochondria, but that they function less well and again improved with exercise training. As mentioned, the mitochondria produce ROS, and we measured also the ROS emission in this system. And here we see that there's an increased ROS emission with age, and this it's no longer significantly different, indicating that there might be an effect of exercise training, although it's not significantly different from the aged untrained. But the knockouts do not seem to benefit from this exercise training in the ROS emission. And when we measure the protein carbon relation as a measure of oxidative stress, then we can see that there is indeed increased protein carbon relation in the controls, indicating more oxidative stress in parallel with the increased ROS emission that we observed. And this tends to be rescued with exercise training. Measuring lipid peroxidation as another measure of oxidative damage, we did not see these changes with age or exercise training, but there's a higher level in the knockouts, which may affect the function. So aging reduced mitochondrial function in mouse muscle, and exercise training at old age reversed this. And P2N alpha was in part required for this at the low ADP concentration. So this may suggest that P2N alpha is mediating this effect on function through effects on the structure. We then turn to a human subjects and ask whether aging and lifelong exercise training affect mitochondrial function and structure in human skeletal muscle. And we had a young group, an age group between 65 and 73 years old. They are healthy age subjects. They do exercise with biking around in Copenhagen, but do not do any sports and have never done it. The age trained subjects, they are moderately trained throughout life. And then we have a group of highly trained that bike like 100 kilometers a day, almost every day of the week. And this shows the CS activity. There's no change with age as long as this is healthy aging, but with high volume of training, there's more CS activity. Going to the respiration, here we have complex one linked leak respiration, one and two linked leak respiration, and respiration with high ADP concentration. And you can see that the picture is very similar. There's no effect of aging and moderately exercise training, but with high levels of training, then there's higher respiration, both at leak and with high ADP concentrations. If we normalize to the CS activity and thereby get a measure of intrinsic respiration or activity of the mitochondria, then there don't seem to be much difference between, and if anything, the highly trained have lower intrinsic activity. This indicates that the higher level of respiration up here, that is not due to changes in intrinsic activity, but fully due to more mitochondria. We also looked at the structure, and by doing the fragmentation index, there's no difference between the first three groups, but there's a lower fragmentation index in the highly trained. So it seems that healthy aging did not affect mitochondrial function or structure, but a high volume of exercise training did increase mitochondrial respiration and reduced the mitochondrial fragmentation in age subjects. And the last part in the same study, but focus on the human adipose tissue. So we took adipose tissue biopsies from the abdominal area. The total OxPhos protein level is higher in the moderately trained and the highly trained. The CS activity really clearly higher in the highly trained, but not different in the other groups, and a similar picture of mitochondrial DNA. So it does seem that training, both at a moderately level, but especially a high level, is affecting the mitochondrial content in adipose tissue. The respiration was not different between the first three groups, but the highly trained had higher respiration, especially with ADP present. When we normalized to mitochondrial DNA, that showed that aging, all three age groups had lower level of respiration, indicating that aging is associated with reduced intrinsic activity in adipose tissue mitochondria, and that the highly trained subjects, they kind of supercompensate, or they compensate for that by having more mitochondria, but they are not changing the intrinsic activity. And the highly trained subjects, they have also less ROS emission, and they rescue an increased ROS emission seen with aged untrained subjects, indicating also a beneficial effect. So aging was associated with reduced intrinsic mitochondrial function and increased ROS emission in human adipose tissue. High volume exercise training reduced ROS emission and increased total mitochondrial respiration in human adipose tissue, but without affecting the intrinsic mitochondrial respiration. So exercise training increased the content of key autophagy and mitophagy proteins in human skeletal muscle. It seems that P2N alpha is required for several of these effects. P2N alpha was required for preventing and reversal mitochondrial fragmentation, and in part also for the beneficial effects on mitochondrial function with exercise training at old age. And it may suggest that P2N alpha is mediating functional effect by affecting mitochondrial structure. Healthy aging may affect intrinsic mitochondrial function and fragmentation in human muscle, does not affect, but high volume exercise training increases respiration and reduces fragmentation. And also adipose tissue is affected by aging. Intrinsic activity is decreased, but it's possible to increase the content of mitochondria and thereby respiration. So time is running out, and I would like to thank the funding agencies and my collaborators but especially the people in the lab, in the group, doing all the hard work. So thank you for listening, and I'm sorry that I went on so long.
Thank you very much, Henry. I think we, in fairness, we started late, so I think you're probably perfectly on time. I might just, I'm not exactly sure if they're going to kick us off at the end. So just in the interest of time, I might get people to save questions until the end and we'll keep moving. Just, it's a bit weird not knowing who's who's listening and watching out there, but you can, there is a chat room where you can put questions in there, and we'll, if you want to do that as we're going along, we can collate those at the end, and we'll, if we've got time, we'll answer as many of those as we can. So thanks.
Yes, so then I think we can move on, and I would like to introduce David Bishop as the next speaker. And David is a professor at the Institute for Health and Sport at Victoria University, at Melbourne University. And David has a long record of knowledge within exercise training and mitochondria, among others. So we very much look forward to your presentation, David.
Thank you, Henriette. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for joining. And I'll continue this presentation from lockdown here in Melbourne. One of the things that the current pandemic has highlighted is the is importance of regular exercise. And one really good reason to exercise is to keep our mitochondria healthy. There's been research on exercise and mitochondria for close to 100 years now. And as Henriette highlighted, probably one of the most famous studies is this one by John Polozzi, where he showed in rats that with exercise training, there's a large increase in mitochondrial protein content. Less well known, though, was actually this Ukrainian study that was conducted nearly 30 years earlier. And what they also showed in rats is that with exercise training, there's a significant increase in mitochondrial respiration in rat skeletal muscle. Despite all of this research, one of the remaining and I guess sometimes controversial questions, which Henriette actually touched on, is what is the optimal exercise prescription to promote mitochondrial adaptations? And so one of the goals of my presentation today is to mostly show you unpublished research that has tried to answer this question. Before I start, though, I'd like to just define some of the terms and concepts that I'll be using in this presentation, just because they can be different from between different research groups. So typically when we're assessing changes in mitochondria, probably the two main factors are some measure of mitochondrial content and some measure of the function or the ability of mitochondria to produce ATP. Typically, though, we don't measure ATP directly, but we measure the consumption of oxygen as an indirect measure of energy production, ATP production. Now, with training or indeed other interventions, there's a number of different ways that the mitochondria may adapt. So there may be an increase in mitochondrial content, and this might be accompanied by a proportional increase in mitochondrial respiration. So what we would say here is that there's an increase in mass-specific mitochondrial respiration. So an increase in respiration per milligram of muscle that we put into the respirometer. It's also possible that there might be a greater increase in respiration relative to the increase in mitochondrial content. So in this case, you would see both an increase in mass-specific mitochondrial respiration, or also what we've termed mitochondrial-specific respiration, or Henriette referred to as intrinsic respiration in her talk. It's also possible that there might be a relatively lower increase in respiration relative to the increase in mitochondrial content. So in this case, you'd see an increase in mass-specific respiration, but a decrease in intrinsic or mitochondrial-specific respiration. And it's also possible to have little or no change in mitochondrial content, but a proportionally greater increase in mitochondrial respiration. So in this case, you would see an increase in mitochondria-specific respiration. I'd like to also address briefly just some of the exercise terms as well, because again, these can differ between laboratories. So I'll be referring to moderate intensity continuous training, which is typically continuous training performed between about 50 and 80% of heart rate or VO2 max. High intensity interval training, which consists of intervals that are typically performed between around about 80% and 100% of heart rate VO2 max or VO2 max. And then I'll use a separate category for sprint interval training, which is normally shorter but very high intensity intervals performed at an intensity that is above the intensity of VO2 max. Most of the research I'll be presenting today is analyses of skeletal muscle biopsies that we've taken from human participants before and after different exercise training programs. And as I said, I'll be concentrating specifically on mitochondria. So let's have a look at how mitochondria respond to exercise. Probably one of the most controversial topics is the role of exercise volume. And we recently participated in this crosstalk in Journal of Physiology with Marty Gabala, where we argued, based on looking at most of the studies that have been done to date, that we see a correlation between exercise volume and changes in citrate synthase activity as an indirect marker of mitochondrial content. And obviously you can see from the scattering of points there, that's not always the case in every study, but we argued that the correlation would suggest that that training volume is an important determinant of changes in mitochondrial content. There was probably more than 30 comments from some of the best scientists in the field on this topic, some supporting what we believe and I guess others not agreeing with us, but I think that just highlights the controversy, and I guess that there's no consensus yet on the role of volume versus intensity in improving mitochondrial content. But I'll present some of our more recent data, which I think provides some further support for our position that training volume is one of the more important training variables. One of the things that I think it's important to highlight, and a limitation, I think, of a lot of the research that has been done to date, is that using one protein, in this case, citrate synthase, out of one of the more than 1,200 proteins within the mitochondria to represent changes in mitochondrial content needs to be done with caution. And indeed, in this some of our latest data, which is in second review in Nature Communications, we highlighted that the different mitochondrial proteins respond in a different fashion to the training. So even though overall we see an increase in mitochondrial content, you can see on the right there, we saw different clusters. So we saw some mitochondrial proteins that increased relative to the change in mitochondrial content, whereas we also see some mitochondrial proteins that decrease relative to the change in mitochondrial content. So again, suggesting that caution is warranted when trying to interpret changes in mitochondrial content from a single protein. However, we've also, in some other research, we have shown that with greater volumes of training, we see greater improvements in mitochondrial content, regardless of how we measure it. So you can see whether we measure more micrograms of protein in our fractions, citrate synthase activity, or if we look at the average of the intensity from our proteomic results. So at least in our view, this lends some further support to the idea that training volume is an important determinant of changes in mitochondrial content. Using electron microscopy, which many consider to be the gold standard for measuring changes in mitochondrial content, the results of a number of researchers, which is summarized here, also suggests that there is a relationship between greater training volumes and greater changes in mitochondrial content. And some of our more recent unpublished research from Javier Botella, we've shown that when we compared very high volume training with very high intensity training, we only see significant increases in mitochondrial volume density measured with TEM, or also citrate synthase activity as an indirect marker of mitochondrial content, when we do the high volume continuous training. So that, again, I think, at least I said, in our view, adds the support that training volume is an important determinant of mitochondrial changes in mitochondrial content. And I guess the question is, what might be some of the mechanisms that underlie the powerful effect of training volume? And one hypothesis that a number of researchers have put forward is that it may be related to changes in muscle glycogen. And indeed, in an unpublished, hopefully soon to be published, meta-analysis, we've seen a correlation between changes in muscle glycogen during exercise and activation of AMPK, which is an important regulator of mitochondrial biogenesis. Other studies have also shown that if you do exercise with lowered muscle glycogen levels, that there's a greater exercise-induced increase in PGC1-alpha. So painting the picture that changes in muscle glycogen with longer volume training may be part of the picture that helps to explain the powerful effect of high volume training. So just to summarize, I think, you know, we still don't have a consensus, and, you know, that may be somewhat controversial, but at least a lot of the research coming from our laboratory would support the idea that training volume is an important determinant of changes in mitochondrial content. If we now look at exercise intensity, this is the result from a review that we published a few years ago. And what this review seemed to suggest was that the greatest changes in mass-specific mitochondrial respiration were achieved when exercise is performed close to the VO2 max intensity. So that suggests that intensity is an important, in contrast to, I guess, what I just showed for mitochondrial content, that intensity may be a more important determinant of changes in mitochondrial respiration, and in particular, mass-specific mitochondrial respiration. Interestingly, however, we've shown in another study that sprint interval training leads to much greater increases in mitochondrial specific respiration. So that's changes in respiration measured in permeabilized muscle fibers, but normalized to the change in mitochondrial content. So again, one of the questions that we're interested in is, what might be some of the mechanisms that underlie the powerful effect of intensity in promoting these mitochondrial adaptations? And one hypothesis that has been put forward is that when participants perform high intensity exercise training, there might be a greater involvement of the type 2 fibers due to the size principle, and this might be contributing to the greater mitochondrial adaptations with high intensity exercise. So to try and test this hypothesis, we took muscle biopsies before and after moderate intensity continuous training and high intensity training. We then separated and pooled the type 1 and type 2 fibers and did a proteomic analysis specifically focusing on changes in mitochondrial proteins in these single fibers. And just very briefly, we saw some of these results. If you look to the right, probably as expected, we saw that with moderate intensity continuous training, we only saw changes in mitochondrial proteins in the type 1 fibers, and we really didn't see any changes in the type 2 fibers. However, and somewhat surprisingly, we only saw decreases in all of these mitochondrial proteins with sprint interval training in both the type 1 and the type 2 fibers. Now, it's important to remember this is just changes in mitochondrial content, and it may be that changes in mitochondrial function or mitochondrial respiration may be different, but we weren't able to measure those. And I'll just mention briefly that Liz, who did the did this experiment, she has a recorded oral presentation where you can, if you're interested, you can get more information on this particular study. We're also interested in the effects of different exercise intensities on the transcriptional programs that underlie mitochondrial biogenesis. So we conducted this study where we had participants in a random order perform three different exercise intensities, either low intensity below the first lactate threshold, moderate intensity, or high intensity, which was above the maximal lactate steady state. And we took muscle biopsies at rest, immediately post, and 3 hours post each of these exercise intensities. We then performed RNA-seq on these muscle samples, and I'll show you just the changes in the 3 hour post relative to the resting sample. And what was, I think, very interesting is that we saw very little difference between the number of differentially expressed genes between the low intensity and the moderate intensity exercise, but we saw almost double the number of differentially expressed genes in the high intensity following the high intensity exercise. And this was also dominated by a lot of mitochondrial genes. So that matches up, I think, with why some of the beneficial effects of performing the high intensity exercise. There's a lot of things that happen, you know, obviously metabolically when you go above the maximal lactate steady state. But one of the obvious differences that you can see in the top left corner here is that when you do high intensity exercise above the maximal lactate steady state, there's a much greater increase in blood lactate and also muscle lactate. And so that may help to explain the greater activation of these transcriptional programs with the high intensity exercise. And just briefly, there's some interesting research out there that supports the role of lactate. This classic study by Hashimoto from George Brooks' lab showed that when they added lactate to L6 myotubes, they see a greater increase in DNA binding of ROS responsive transcription factors. There's also a really interesting study just a couple of years ago in Nature showing that with lactate contributes to lactylation, where lactate binds to a lactyl group, it binds to histones and increases transcription. And we also published a study a couple of years ago, again in L6 cell culture, showing that when we added lactate to the myotubes, we saw a decrease in nuclear HDAC, which would lead to a more open chromatin structure and would facilitate transcription. So there's quite a few potential mechanisms by which performing exercise above the maximal lactate steady state, which promotes greater changes in lactate, might contribute to the greater activation of these transcriptional programs with high intensity exercise. As I mentioned, there's obviously lots of other changes, metabolic changes when exercise is performed above the lactate threshold, but we've also in the meta-analysis that I mentioned shown that there's a correlation between changes in free ADP and ADP activation. So it's probably, you know, it's never just one thing, it's probably not just lactate, but the greater homeostatic perturbations that are occurring exercises performed above the maximal lactate steady state are probably contributing to the greater activation of these transcriptional programs. I've also got some other, I think, really interesting unpublished research from our lab, and this is from Javier Botella, showing that when we do sprint interval exercise, we also see a greater number of damaged mitochondria when we look at the electron mitographs. And it may be that this greater mitochondrial stress is contributing to the activation of these transcriptional programs with high intensity exercise. And when we also subjected this muscle to RNA-seq, you can see here that the transcriptional programs activated by moderate intensity exercise compared to sprint interval exercise are very different and distinct. And what was interesting here, we saw that with sprint interval exercise, there was a much greater activation of protein localization to the mitochondria. So again, it could be that the stress of this high intensity exercise, the mitochondrial stress, is activating these mitochondrial transcriptional programs. And this is it's a topic that we're exploring at the moment. Given that I've been talking about the role of intensity, I wanted to address this question about whether it's possible to do too much high intensity interval training. And this study from Flock et al. That was just recently published has generated a lot of interest. And it's a really interesting study. And what they showed is these are the different training phases in the different colors, but when they did 152 minutes of high intensity interval training in a week, they reported a significant decrease in mitochondrial respiration in isolated mitochondria. What's interesting though is, you know, we've done a couple of studies now where we've actually done almost four times as much high intensity interval training. We did 40 HIIT sessions in 3 weeks. So they were doing two high intensity interval training sessions a day, 7 days a week for 3 weeks. And in contrast to the results of Flockart, we actually see an increase in mass specific respiration, mitochondrial respiration, but we see no change in intrinsic or mitochondrial specific respiration. So I think this is an interesting topic that requires further research. But one of the points we made with John Hawley and I in a recent editorial is that we need to be careful in extrapolating between different experimental models. So when, for example, in Flockart, they measured in vitro respiration, so in isolated mitochondria, and we know that probably less than 10% of the mitochondrial pool actually survives this process. So I think that, you know, there's questions about the relationship between in vitro mitochondrial respiration, ex vivo mitochondrial respiration in permeabilized fibers, and then again, obviously, between the in vivo mitochondrial respiration. And we need to be careful when extrapolating between all of these. So just to summarize, both high intensity and high volume exercise training are effective at increasing mitochondrial content. However, we would argue that the evidence suggests that training volume is more important to produce the largest changes in mitochondrial content. High intensity, high volume training appears most effective to increase mass mitochondrial respiration, but very high intensity training, for example, sprint interval training, appears most effective to increase mitochondria specific or intrinsic mitochondrial respiration. And more research is required to understand the underlying mechanisms responsible for the divergent mitochondrial adaptations to different exercise prescriptions. So thanks for listening and from joining from, you know, wherever you are in the world at the moment. Thank you. We're back. Great. I might jump straight from presentation to chair. So just to keep us on time, I'll introduce Graham Holloway from Canada, who drew the short straw, I think it's 2 or 3 in the morning in Canada. So first, thank him for agreeing to join this session. Second, thank him for getting out of his pajamas and putting on a shirt. That's much appreciated. And really pleased to have Graham to finish this session. I think there's not too many people who better understand the biology of mitochondria and the response to exercise and nutritional interaction. So I'm really looking forward to this talk. Thanks, Graham.
Thank you very much for the introduction and for getting me out of bed. It's been a great session so far, and I will try to keep us on time. At the outset, I always think it's important to also acknowledge our funding agencies. And this fine gentleman who is, I think, online, because he texted me to say, enjoy your talk too. So Professor Luc Van Loon from Maastricht has been a great collaborator of mine. And we have a co-supervised student, Heather Petrick. And a lot of the research that I'm going to be discussing today was actually generated by that individual. So we've heard a couple of great talks on how exercise can be used as a modality to try to promote mitochondrial adaptations. And in a lot of ways, we view this as a great tool to improve health. We also view disuse or inactivity as another model to try to impair health. I think the two talks that we've had were a little bit easier in that exercise is such a robust tool, and I've been charged with trying to focus a little bit more on nutrition. So where I'm going to go with this is I'm going to try to use high-fat diet as a model to maybe negatively impair health of the individual or the small animal that we study, to try to introduce some novel mechanisms that we can then try to use a couple of different nutritional approaches to try to mitigate. I'll talk about two in particular, polyunsaturated fatty acids, as a way to potentially mitigate the disuse that we see with single leg immobilization in humans. And then I will try to spend quite a bit of time talking about some of the recent work that we have with dietary nitrate on trying to mitigate some of the high-fat diet responses that we see in small animals. So although my title has mitochondrial biogenesis in it, I'm really going to try to talk about the effect of changing mitochondrial content, which is the bioenergetic response within various tissues. As Dr. Bishop also said, there's a lot of terms that you see in the literature. And so while we typically see an increase in mitochondrial content with exercise training that aligns with health, we a lot of times see the term mitochondrial dysfunction in the literature, which is, I know Dr. Bishop and I have talked about this before, going, we don't even know what that means, because it can mean a lot of things to a lot of different people. But I think if you think about it from the classic perspective, it really is just a reduction in mitochondrial content. And we see this change along the spectrum. We typically see a reduction in mitochondrial content in a lot of different pathological states, but it doesn't have to happen. So we really, a couple of years ago, started to ask the question, what changes when we change mitochondrial content? So what is the biological response within skeletal muscle? And if you go back and look at John Halosi's seminal work, he was the one that really postulated that changing mitochondrial content would change the ADP sensitivity of a cell. So we can model that in a test tube. And the way that we do that is using permeabilized muscle fibers. And so in this experiment, on the y-axis, we have our rate of oxygen consumption. And in a test tube, I control titrating in ADP concentrations. The typical experiment that you'll see in the literature uses saturating ADP. So somewhere around 5 millimolar to 10 millimolar ADP. And if we take a healthy individual that is young, we see a consistent respiratory response across those ADP concentrations. So we're at saturating levels, and that's what most people do with experiments. If we look at the literature, we can use exercise to increase mitochondrial content. We can use genetic models that increase PGC1 alpha, as an example, to increase mitochondrial content. And that increases the respiratory capacity of skeletal muscle, and that typically is associated with a healthy phenotype. Conversely, we can use genetic models to decrease mitochondrial content, and that is associated with an unhealthy phenotype. The caveat to that is there are some examples of, I don't want to call it necessarily pathological, but situations that we don't deem to be healthy. Aging is an example of that, where the muscle is maybe a little bit different, But mitochondrial content is actually the same, or the respiratory capacity doesn't always change. And that's led people to start to suggest that mitochondrial content is not the only determinant or of health. But if we think about this from a submax perspective, the classical response is that we actually change respiratory drive at every ADP concentration. So when we change mitochondrial content, we typically change the submax response as well. And from an experimental perspective, if I put in then a known concentration of ADP, whether it's 100 micromolars, we can actually detect then differences in that submax response. But when we look at these other anomalies, like aging, where we don't see a change in the capacity of the system, we do see a change in this submax response. So we've started to think about maybe not looking at the capacity of the system, although mitochondrial content is important, but to really focus in on the biologically relevant submax values, especially when you consider that people that are diabetic or aging are not usually working at their aerobic capacity. In the interest of time, I'm not going to go through all the data, but this is one of the first studies that we did with this in humans with Loop when I was in his lab. And all the data is there on aging skeletal muscle. One of the things that ADP does is it obviously drives respiration, but it also affects the redox balance. And Dr. Pittelgard also alluded to this in her talk. So as ADP moves into the mitochondrial matrix, it combines to ATP synthase and use that proton motive force to drive oxidative phosphorylation. A side effect of the electron transport chain as these electrons move through the system is that they can slip off to molecular oxygen to make superoxide. The less ADP that's inside the matrix, the more reactive oxygen species that are produced, because again, it's just this balance between substrate delivery relative to how much ADP we have within the matrix. We started to think about ADP transport in the context of various pathologies, because if you look at the literature, there's a couple of suggestions that ANT, or the transport protein that's required to move ADP into the matrix, is actually redox sensitive. And if we inhibit ANT through these redox modifications, it blocks ADP transport and therefore exacerbates this ROS emission potential. The other thing that can happen with high fat diets is we have a lot of substrates within the matrix, and so we have excessive acetyl-CoA. And the suggestion has been that that can actually promote acetylation of proteins within the mitochondrial proteome, and ANT has a specific residue that has also been predicted to inhibit ADP transport through acetylation. So we started to ask the question of what happens with a high fat diet, and maybe submax responses are affected. The classic model that people always propose on a high-fat diet for the induction of insulin resistance is that the excessive availability of lipids shifts towards storage, and so we get these reactive lipids like diacylglyceride and ceramides, and a reduction in mitochondrial content has been proposed to exacerbate that phenotype. It's also been proposed to promote reactive oxygen species. The caveat to that is when we high-fat feed an animal, transiently, we induce insulin resistance, and we actually don't see a reduction in mitochondrial content. In some reports, we actually see an increase in mitochondrial content. And that's really the suggestion in the literature as to why changes in mitochondrial capacity are not required for the induction of insulin resistance. If you're interested in some of the signaling mechanisms, we have reported on this before, and mitochondrial ROS seems to induce the fragmentation of the ryanidine receptor to induce calcium leak and activate the typical CAMK2 pathways that leads to mitochondrial biogenesis. But we really wanted to know what was going on at that submax response. So this is our permeabilized fiber preparation using a classical maximal approach. So you have pyruvate malate there on the left side of the graph. Then we have saturated ADP, and in the white bars are the control animals, and the black bars are high-fat fed mice. You can see when we do this, we don't see a reduction in the capacity of the system. But when we start to titrate in ADP and look at submax responses, we see marked impairments when we don't have saturated ADP there. We can then also use Michaelis-Menten kinetic curves to try to estimate the concentration of ADP that's required for half maximal respiration. We term that the apparent KM value. The higher the value, the more ADP is required to get to half maximal respiration. Interestingly, with the high-fat diet, we have this biochemical definition being impaired, and that aligns with the absolute values that are, in my mind, easier to interpret. So there seems to be this high-fat diet-mediated impairment and how we're responding to submaximal ADP. ROS is also important. And again, I said that ADP dissipates the potential of the mitochondria to produce reactive oxygen species. And the high-fat diet also mitigates the ability of ADP to decrease reactive oxygen species. The other aspect that happens on a high-fat diet is we have an increased availability of lipids in the cell, and we know that. There's actually a very tight correlation in humans between the availability of long-chain fatty acids and our glucose infusion rates. One of the things that we have to remember all the time, though, is when we do permeabilized fibers, is we take the muscle out, we separate our fibers out, and we purposely wash out the cytosolic constituents. And so if we had this high lipid environment in the muscle, we actually wash that out before we put it into our respirometer. And so maybe we need to consider what environment we model when we put in our mitochondria into the respirometer. So we started to ask whether or not we should also be considering the availability of the lipids in that in vitro approach. One of the first studies we did was to show that it rapidly inhibits respiration. So this is a real-time trace. So on the x-axis is time. On the y-axis is our respiration. And if you see this thin bar in the background here, this is my control experiment where we just put in saturating ADP and respiration goes consistently over time. At this moment here, though, in the thicker band, we add in a little bit of palmitate-CoA. There's no L-carnitine in there, so we can't transport that into the mitochondrial matrix. It's just trying to model the cytosolic lipid availability. And what happens is you actually impair respiration almost 50% in 15 minutes. We know that this is ADP dependent because if you put in a mitochondrial uncoupler, which removes the necessity of ADP for oxidative phosphorylation, we can fully recover respiration. We thought we were onto something, and then we looked at the literature and somebody else showed this in isolated mitochondria in the 1970s. So we've replicated what other people have shown is that palmitate-CoA can inhibit ADP transport. If we go back and look at the effects of a high-fat diet, then we can model that environment by putting in 60 micromolars of palmitate-CoA. And so this is our ADP titration again. We have our control fed animals in the white bar, our high-fat in the black, and now we're doing high-fat diet plus modeling the high-fat environment. What you can see is, again, an additive effect where the lipid availability seems to impair respiration further. So we have this impairment in submax respiration that is just dependent on the high-fat diet. And then if we model that environment, we can further impair that because of the availability of that intracellular lipid. So we need to consider some of these models when we're trying to utilize in vitro approaches to understand how the mitochondria is interacting with the cell. Really importantly, one of the only slides I get to show on exercise is that it is important and that it can also mitigate the detrimental effects of the lipids. And so this is a study in humans using an ADP titration in the presence of that 60 micromolar of PCOA. And you can almost see that there's no respiratory drive in that experiment. If we exercise train these male individuals up for 6 weeks, we can dramatically attenuate that response. And so even though there's palmitate-CoA in there, we now have this marked drive on respiration after our 6 weeks of exercise training. So it seems that endurance training can attenuate some of the detrimental effects that we see in the presence of a high lipid environment. So when we think about this continuum of health, again, I didn't talk about aging, but it does seem to impair ADP sensitivity as well as insulin resistance. And that is associated with a reduction in our health of our cell. So can we use nutrition to try to improve our ADP sensitivity and our ADP response? And so that's where I'm going with this. The first, what I'm going to utilize is immobilization to try to look at omega-3 fatty acids. I had the opportunity to work with a collaborator down the road at McMaster University, which is about 45 minutes away from us. And that really what Sue Phillips was using was a model where they pre-supplemented with EPA and DHA for a month before doing single leg immobilization with his postdoc at the time, Chris McGlory, who's now a professor at Queen's University. Then we did single leg immobilization and we took biopsies before at 3 days and at 14 days. We either had a control group or we had the omega supplemented group. They have a paper showing on the same participants, these were females, that the reduction in quadriceps volume was attenuated when consuming the omega supplements throughout and before they did the single leg immobilization. So we really wanted to know if mitochondrial bioenergetics were contributing to that response in some manner. Importantly, when we look at omega-3 supplements, we can show in humans that the apparent KM, or that ADP sensitivity, is reduced. So if the apparent KM is lower, I need less ADP to get to half, which is an increase in ADP sensitivity. So this is increased submaximal response. So when we look at the immobilization, the remarkable thing to us was that even after 3 days of single leg immobilization in these females, respiration at the capacity level was reduced and stayed the same over the subsequent 11 days. So we have a marked reduction in the respiratory capacity that happens very quickly with single leg immobilization. And this was completely prevented when they were taking omega-3 supplementation. This also aligns with markers of mitochondrial protein. So in this instance, just the electron transport chain is what I'm showing. So we didn't see the reduction at 3 days, but we do presumably then have that mitophagy pathway to clear those proteins out, and then they're reduced at 14 days. Similar to the function though, omega-3 supplements completely mitigated the loss of the electron transport chain proteins. When we look at submax responses, it follows the same pattern. So we see a reduction with our control individuals at every single submaximal value. And once again, when we look at omegas, that response was completely mitigated. So it definitely seems that the consumption of polyunsaturated fatty acids is in some ways maintaining our respiratory function during single leg immobilization. And that seems to correlate also with preservation of muscle mass when you relate it back to Chris McGlory's other data. We did not see a reduction or an increase in hydrogen peroxide emission assays. So this is surprising in the context of some of the literature in rodents, but we've also shown this with when I was in Luke's lab looking at short-term bed rest. And so we've done a couple of different models of disuse, and 7 days of bed rest also did not increase our mitochondrial emission assays in humans. So it seems to be a consistent finding. So we don't really know what's going on in terms of the mechanism of action. I think that that needs to be acknowledged. But we have shown in previous studies as well that these PUFAs can maintain insulin sensitivity in obese lines as well. So there seems to be a consistent finding that these PUFAs can affect mitochondrial bioenergetics and can impact the cell in lots of different ways. So I'm going to pivot now and try to go after using nutrition to mitigate or prevent the high-fat diet responses as opposed to immobilization. And for that, I'm really going to focus in on dietary nitrate. We were studying dietary nitrate at the time for performance adaptations and exercise responses. And then we started to read the literature in a broader context and realized that there's actually been a wealth of literature over the last couple of decades looking at the potential positive impacts on cellular health. This is one of the more recent ones, but there are a number of examples that have shown in rodents that nitrate can prevent the detrimental effects of a high-fat diet. So in this particular experiment, they're looking at high-fat feeding, and the red line is the glucose tolerance of the high-fat fed animals. And the green line, which is markedly improved, are high-fat fed mice that are consuming nitrate in the drinking water. So it can prevent the detrimental effects. Now, in our hands, we don't see an increase in mitochondrial bioenergetics in healthy individuals. So we've done this with beetroot juice, but we've also done this in rodents with sodium nitrate. So in an unstressed situation, dietary nitrate of any source doesn't seem to affect mitochondrial bioenergetics. But what we wanted to know was, could the nitrate supplementation maintain mitochondrial bioenergetics in the face of a high-fat diet to contribute to that preservation of glucose tolerance? So this is the work of two people, Heather Petrick, who is again that co-supervised student with Luke Van Loon, and another individual who is a visiting scientist in my lab, Dr. Henry Brunetta. And what we did was we high-fat fed mice for 8 weeks, and then we performed a battery of tests at the end of the 8 weeks. Half of the animals consumed 4 millimolar nitrate in the drinking water on the high-fat diet. So we have three groups: a control, high-fat fed, and high-fat fed with nitrate. We have a host of experiments and tissue collections at the end. The first thing we needed to do is to show that the nitrate worked. So our serum assays show that the combined nitrate goes up after the 8 weeks of the diet, so we know it worked. We can replicate what these other scientists have shown, is that dietary nitrate can preserve glucose tolerance. And then we wanted to look at a couple of tissues that are important for whole body glucose control. So liver, adipose tissue, and skeletal muscle are going to be the three that I'm going to focus in on first. And then I will move to the cardiac function that we have as well. Within the liver, there's a recent paper showing that dietary nitrate prevents liver steatosis. We can confirm that. We can do that with imaging. We've also done that with a typical Fulch extraction and GC analysis. When we looked at the respiration of the liver, there was no change in our respiratory capacity of the system. There is no change in our ADP response or submaximal responses within the liver. But we did see this reduction in hydrogen peroxide emission within the liver tissue. So we see the gray bar is the high fat fed animal and the black bar is the nitrate consuming high fat fed animals. That aligns with a preservation of markers of redox imbalance. So in this instance, just T-bars. We've also looked at adipose tissue, and in this instance, you actually see an increase in mitochondrial respiratory capacity per adipose cell with a high-fat diet, and nitrate did not alter that. When we looked at mitochondrial ROS emission assays, though, we see something similar to the liver, that there's a marked increase on the high-fat diet, and dietary nitrate prevented that, or at least in this instance, attenuated it. There's lots of examples that we have of cellular homeostasis, whether it's J and K markers. I've just cherry-picked this in terms of crown-like structures to show that we could also improve some markers of cellular stress within the white adipose tissue. We then really wanted to look at the skeletal muscle because we obviously know that skeletal muscle is important for glucose control. And so this is just insulin-stimulated signaling to show that the skeletal muscle was responsive to our diet. So our controls had a marked increase in AKT phosphorylation in the presence of insulin, obviously dramatically attenuated on a high fat diet, and the dietary nitrate preserves that to some degree. When we looked at our submax responses for ADP, again, a higher KM value means I need more ADP to get to half maximal. So that's impaired on the high fat diet, lining up with our previous data, and dietary nitrate fully prevented that response. That's a biochemical definition. Again, sometimes it's easier to look at absolute values. And so this is an absolute just respiratory response in the presence of 25 micromolars of ADP, lower on the high fat diet, preserved with dietary nitrate. So it seems like dietary nitrate prevents the reductions in submaximal respiration. That lines up with mitochondrial specific acetylation. So when we look at isolated mitochondria, acetylation goes up on the high fat diet, and it is normalized in the presence of nitrate. We did notice that that also lines up with the reduction in SIRT1 total cellular protein that is normalized or maintained with the dietary nitrate. So we started to wonder if SIRT1 was contributing to that acetylation responses. Now, if we isolate mitochondria, we don't detect SIRT1 in the isolated mitochondria. So if it's doing something, it has to be a protein that's exposed to the intermembrane space or to the cytosol. And that's where that site of ANT is located. So we were wondering if that could be contributing to some of the cellular responses that we're seeing. Now, to do that, we then went to a conditional knockout of SIRT1. So we could knock out SIRT1. When we then put those knockouts on a high fat diet in the presence of nitrate no longer affects glucose homeostasis. And if we just in the interest of time, look at that acetylation status of our isolated mitochondria, we no longer have the beneficial effects of nitrate affecting mitochondrial acetylation as well. So it seems like SIRT1 is preventing or the knocking out SIRT1, I should say, is preventing some of the beneficial effects that we see with dietary nitrate in muscle. One of the responses that also happens with nitrate is obviously blood pressure changes. And so we were also particularly interested in looking at the heart. We have a lot of data on the heart. we can use echocardiograms to show that stroke volume goes down on a high-fat diet and nitrate preserves it. We can look at markers of fibrosis to show that. And so there's a lot of examples where left ventricular morphology is detrimentally affected on a high-fat diet and preserved with dietary nitrate. When we look at our respiratory responses, our typical markers of ADP capacity don't change, nor does our ADP sensitivity. In our hands, we almost never get a change in respiratory responses within the LV on these high-fat diets. So dietary nitrate is not changing the respiratory capacity or sensitivity within the heart. But similar to the other tissues, it is reducing the propensity to produce hydrogen peroxide. So capacity measurements in succinate or in the presence of 100 micromolars of ADP, it seems to be improved with nitrate. So it seems similar to what we're seeing within the white adipose tissue in the liver. No change in respiration, but an increase in ROS in the high-fat diet that's prevented with nitrate. We do know that nitrate requires bacteria to be serially reduced to nitrite, which eventually has a bioactive component within the production of nitric oxide. The gut microbiome has also been implicated in actually a cardiovascular axis. And so we really wanted to know what the role of the gut microbiome is in some of these responses. So we can sequence the gut microbiome, and at the phylum level, we can see the typical responses within the high-fat diet animals, and those are fully prevented with dietary nitrate. So it seems like at the gross phylum level, there are changes in the gut microbiome that can be mitigated with nitrate consumption. We then looked at the amount of nitrate in our fecal samples, and importantly, there was no difference in dietary nitrate. So we actually took those fecal pellets and did a transplant into other high-fat fed animals during an 8-week study. So we waited 6 weeks on a high-fat diet, gavaged them 3 separate days, waited 9 days afterwards, and then did our tissue collection. Importantly, there's no change in serum nitrate on these animals, which shouldn't surprise us because there was no increase in fecal nitrate in those animals as well. We did not change systolic blood pressure or diastolic blood pressure in these animals, which again becomes an important model distinction than when they're consuming nitrate. So we have no change in serum nitrate, no change in blood pressure. And so then we can ask the question of what is going on within the context of the cardiovascular system. Despite those absence of changes, once again, 10 or 9 days after the consumption of our gavage of the fecal transplant, we have an improvement in end-diastolic volume. We have an improvement in stroke volume without a change in fibrosis. And so this fecal transplant, despite the absence of some of the circulatory changes that you would expect with nitrate, they still improved something within the LV. When we looked at our respiration again, no difference, but we never see respiratory changes in the heart in our hands. But we once again saw this microbial transplant reduced mitochondrial ROS emission. So it seems like the cardioprotective effect is not dependent on circulating nitrate in these animals, and the circulating nitrate is not required for the reduction in ROS within the LV. That's a little bit different than our other tissues, because if we go back to white adipose tissue, we no longer see an improvement in crown-like structures. We no longer see an improvement in J&K phosphorylation or a reduction in ROS rates. If we look at muscle, there's no change in ADP sensitivity anymore, whether I look at the KM value or at the absolute submaximal level. So it seems like the circulating nitrate might be required for some of these responses in these other tissues, or our timing wasn't appropriate to detect it. But at least within the heart, we could detect marked changes after these fecal microbial transplants. So I really want to stress that I think we need to start considering some of the submax responses and go back and read our old literature, because John Halozzi was onto something a long time ago. I think that that translates not just in terms of fuel utilization from an exercise perspective. I do think it has translation to understanding health across a number of different situations. So hopefully I've convinced everybody that we need to consider ADP sensitivity or responsiveness in our experimental models. It seems to be attenuated with a number of diseases, so whether it's aging or insulin resistance or high-fat diet. It seems to contribute to redox stress in a lot of these different situations. And it, importantly, lots of lifestyle approaches. I've talked about dietary approaches today, but exercise can also alter ADP sensitivity. We have a list of acknowledgements again, and thank you for your time. And hopefully I'm within my window of 25 minutes.
Perfect. Thanks, Wayne. That was great and perfect timing. I'm not exactly sure we're all learning as we go with this. We're pretty close to the final time, but hopefully we'll all get to catch up in the same room at some stage to have some of these conversations. I think one question, at least from me, to finish, I think, which cuts across maybe the three presentations, is 100% agree with you. I think, you know, measuring ADP sensitivity and I guess the classical relationship with mitochondrial content. But both you and Henriette, I guess, also showed quite some examples of where that association seems to break down. Henriette showed with her knockout mice where she could get an increase in ADP sensitivity, but without an increase in the mitochondrial content in the knockouts. And also, you know, with the high fat diet, you can get an increase in mitochondrial content, but with probably the opposite, you know, worsening or certainly not improvement in ADP sensitivity. What do you think's going on there? You've got 30 seconds.
Well, I mean, that's a very loaded question. But I think there's lots of examples. The first experiment that we actually did with this was Chris Perry, when he was coming up from Gerald Neufer's lab and was looking at this, was just acute exercise. So in healthy individuals, if you do acute exercise, 2 hours of endurance training or 2 hours of endurance exercise impairs ADP sensitivity. So there's no change in mitochondrial content in 2 hours. And that was the first proof of principle to us that you could change the dynamic response of mitochondria in the absence of changing the content. I actually think it gets back to some of what you're looking at, which is something that has been known in the literature for a while. If you do 2 hours of exercise, we are at steady state and that VO2 doesn't change, but cellular free ADP goes up. So Glenn McConnell has a lot of that data as well. So free ADP goes up over a 2 hour bout of exercise. And the question should have always been, why is free ADP going up in the cell when we're actually not using it because VO2 stays constant? And when we started to do those ADP titrations, we realized that the dynamic response of the mitochondria actually lines up with some of our in vivo knowledge in terms of what's going on. And that could be there to mobilize glycogen utilization from a fuel preference perspective. And so if we accumulate free ADP, we activate glycogen phosphorylase at a time when the glycogen granular is getting smaller because you have all those debranching enzymes and you've got phosphorylase that has a certain surface area for that glycogen granule. And when you look at the tier system, it goes down exponentially. So maybe we have to activate phosphorylase more with exercise to keep mobilizing glucose units from glycogen. And one of the best ways to do that is to actually have ADP there to change the allosteric control of it, to change the sensitivity, because that's what it does. So I think there's lots of examples and it becomes more and more complicated the more I think about it. And so the harder question to me is mechanistically, what is changing at the level of the mitochondria to control that? And considering it can go both ways, and to me, it can be transient and it can be rigid. I don't think damage is the only thing that's going on as an example, because why would we ever evolve to then do acute exercise and damage the mitochondria to impair ADP sensitivity, to have to remake all of the proteins? That just doesn't seem like a very efficient way to design the system. So it's got to be something that is transient. It can't just be as simple as redox damage, which is some of the literature that is a little bit older in terms of both what they're studying, because they're actually studying aged individuals or aged houseflies or other things. as well as age in terms of when it was published.
Yeah, no, great. Thanks, mate. And what about maybe just to finish with one question, especially for you, I appreciate you staying up very late there in Canada. I mean, you looked at some of that, Henriette. So what, you know, you suggested that, you know, the studies that you saw an increase in ADP sensitivity without a change in mitochondrial content, or at least the your assessment of mitochondrial content, and you suggested that maybe it's linked to the some sort of mitochondrial ultrastructure changes. Is that what you guys believe?
Yeah, well, I totally agree with both of you that it's very complicated and many factors are likely involved. And I think it's very intriguing that it can be so acutely changed. Of course, it's likely not the only explanation, but we do see that there could be a link between the structure and the function, at least in the changes that we see that they follow each other in the studies that we have done, both in mice and in humans. So I think it's a possibility that the structure will become more efficient and less efficient, and that may be a very acute change that it doesn't need to take long, but it may be acutely affected and affecting the efficiency of the pathways and the use. So that's at least what I think I would like to pursue.
The trick with that is, does the structure affect metabolism and metabolism affect ADP transport, or is it independent of that and it's the structure itself, which I also have been thinking about that for a while. I mean, you have an intermembrane space, and if we change structure, if I swell, maybe that intermembrane space becomes smaller and now I have more efficient transfer from the cytosol through VDAC and ANT, because we normally have kinase to concentrate ADP in that space. And if the distance between the outer and inner mitochondrial membrane changes, then that's important. And I mean, all of those factors could do it. So
yeah,
it'll keep everybody asking questions for many years to come.
I agree. Yeah.
No, obviously, I mean, you mentioned it really well. I mean, the classic thing with any of this is we're talking about integrated physiology, and there's going to be more than one thing that's going on there. As much as we'd like to see that this thing is affecting this one thing is affecting ADP sensitivity, it'd be nice if science was that simple. I think in the interest of time, again, thanks to both of you for participating in this strange virtual conference world. Appreciate the effort that you put into some great presentations, and I hope we get to have this conversation in person in the not too distant future.
Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Agreed. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you both.
See ya. Bye.
Bye.